And I am excited. I am really excited to get into the Word of God with you this morning. But I have to issue a disclaimer here, okay? A disclaimer in that this is not a typical, stereotypical Mother's Day message, all right? Very rare. I got one. Woo, good. I have rarely preach a, maybe early on, maybe in my ministry, I did this a time or two, you know, but rarely have I preached a stereotypical Mother's Day message. You know, I've never preached on how to be a Proverbs 31 lady. I wouldn't even know how to do that. I wouldn't know how to preach that message. And if I did preach that message, you have to understand, I would lose my wife at Proverbs 31, 15, where it says she rises before dawn to fix breakfast for her household. That would be a hard no for my wife. I'd be like, nope, not because she's lazy. She's a great mom and a great cook, and she loves us, but the rising before dawn part, no. She loves her sleep, and so she deserves it, right? And then I've never preached a message on seven ways to love your mother or the mystery of magnificent motherhood. That was actually a sermon title. I saw that this week online, the magnificent Mystery of Magnificent Motherhood. So I've never preached those messages. And listen, I'm not making fun. It's not because I don't believe in the principles found in Proverbs 31. It's not because I don't want you to love your mother better. It's not because I don't believe that motherhood is magnificent, because it absolutely is. It's just I realize that on a day like today, if there's any day that I'm more aware of this, it's this day right here, that we are such a large and diverse congregation. We're such a large and diverse congregation. And here's another reason why. More than anything, I think what you need most is relevant. What would bless your life most, moms, agree with me if you can, that what would bless your life most is the relevant, real, powerful truth from God's Word in your everyday lives, not some sentimental cliches thrown out once a year. Amen? Is that right, moms? Yeah, I think that would be, well, I know it's what would bless me. I hope it blesses you as well. And also, again, I'm more aware today than ever what a large and diverse church we have. I mean, the reality is some of you are not moms. Some of you will never be moms. And the reason is because you're men. There's a lot of men in our church. And so, and then also I realize that the experiences of today, every year I realize this more and more, the experiences of today are as diverse as the number of people here, number of people watching right now online. For some, it's an exciting day. It's a joyful day. It's a day they've been looking forward to. For others of you, the grief runs deep. It's a hard day for some. For some of you, you got a little tinge of disappointment in your heart because you know things, you're not able to be with your mom, or maybe you're not with your kids today for whatever reason. But for others of you, it runs much deeper than that because you've lost a mom, you've lost children perhaps. You carry around the pain of infertility perhaps. For some of you, you know, some of you are excited to be here. You couldn't wait. For some of you, are excited to tune in online and hear this and experience this worship service. For others, it's like, man, this is a very difficult day. In fact, I even heard from some dear friends of mine who said, we can't do it today. We can't make ourselves go in the building. And that's okay. It doesn't demonstrate a lack of love for God or anything like that. That's just part of the healing process. And God will help those folks. But we're glad you're here. And so whoever you are and where you've gathered from and whatever experience you're in, we pray that you're strengthened today. I pray that you're encouraged today. And so I want to jump in into the Word of God. We're going to be reading a passage from Genesis 24. Genesis 24. And as God just began to speak to me, I just began to be more filled with confidence that this is the word he had for us today. And he began to reveal himself to me. I thought, you know what? I bet some moms here today would benefit from this. I bet some folks here today listening online would really be encouraged in their faith this week because of this. So Genesis chapter 24, Genesis 24. Now, I have to tell you, as we get into this, this is a passage that many of you, or some of you may say, you know, I'm not familiar with that passage at all. You may say, in fact, I've never read it in my life, but I don't want you to be intimidated by that. I don't want you to be turned off by that, because before we leave here today, I promise you, you're going to get a picture that God's going to paint for you through his Holy Spirit, a picture of the awesome power of God's presence. That's what we're going to learn in this passage, okay? The awesome power of God's presence, all right? And so let me just ask you this right now. What are you currently experiencing in life? What are you currently going through? Where do you most need the power of God's presence in your life? Is there an area of your life that perhaps you need a miracle? You need God to come through in a big time way. Is there a need for a breakthrough in your marriage? Maybe there's a need for God's mighty, powerful hand to be manifested in the life of one of your kids. Maybe what you're going through most and what's heaviest on your heart has to do with something going on with one of your children. How about in the area of your finances or your health, or to reconcile a relationship. But you know deep down, if it's ever going to change, if there's ever going to be something to move the needle, it's going to come as you are in the presence of God. It's going to come from God's presence. So what is that for you? What are you absolutely depending on God for? Is there some problem that you need an answer to? Is there some crisis brewing in your life? Is there some season right now that you're trying to navigate, or some decision that you desperately need a word of the Lord from? You have to hear from Him soon. Well, I just want to encourage you this morning. Moms, dads, parents, anybody, everybody watching right now, I want to encourage you and let you know that what you need the most, it's going to come in this way. It's going to come from living in and continually walking in. The Bible sometimes uses language like abiding or dwelling in the presence of God. That's where it's going to come. So Genesis 24, now before we read this, I have to come back and pick up a little background of the story, okay? Because we're breaking into the middle of a very large story here, and it's actually a guy retelling the story to somebody else, and so it could be a little confusing, but we got to do this to help it make sense to us and help us to live this out in our daily lives this week. So this is a little bit of history, actually a lot of history, okay? But don't be bored and don't tune this out, because I promise you, it's going to be awesome when we get to the end, okay? I'm going to bring it all together, and you're going to walk out here feeling like, yes, I heard from God, and I feel strengthened in my spirit to go on, because I know God's going ahead of me. All right, so here's the history, okay? You may remember a couple named Abraham and Sarah, okay? Their story dominates a lot of Genesis, the father and mother of many nations. God had made these fantastic promises to them. We actually talked about their story. I think it was in the series on miracles, okay? When we talked about, do you need a miracle and all that, that whole story or that whole series, we talked about Abraham and Sarah having their son, the promised son that God promised them, Isaac, at their very old age, well beyond childbearing years. God breaks in their life and does this miracle. Well, this story surrounds them. It's actually the servant of Abraham who's retelling this story, okay? And now Sarah has been gone for a while. Isaac lost his mom. She's passed away. Abraham nears the time of his death. He knows that this may be one of the last chances ever that he can personally help his son Isaac, help him find a suitable partner in life. That's what the story surrounds, trying to find a wife for Isaac, okay? Now, another important detail in this whole story, before we actually read, is that Abraham and Isaac are now living in a land called Canaan. You probably heard that term before. That's a very significant part of God's salvation, redemption history, okay? It's a promise to the people of God to give them their very own land and make them a blessing that would be apparent to all the other nations around them. And so this is the land of Canaan. This is what he promised Abraham way, way back at Genesis 12. But Abraham is very, very insistent that Isaac not get a wife from the land of the Canaanites. And the reason is very simple. It actually has nothing to do with race or ethnicity or any kind of racial prejudice or anything like that. It's just he wants a godly wife for Isaac. And see, the Canaanites worship many, many different gods. Their worship included things like sexual immorality. They were steeped in spiritual idolatry. And so Abraham knows that it's going to be very, very difficult for Isaac to move forward in the plans and the purposes that God has for him if his wife's not on the same page spiritually. And that makes sense, doesn't it? I think probably every parent in here can understand that today, every person. The Bible's pretty clear on this, that we're not to be unequally yoked. Not in relationships, not in marriage, not in business, not in partnerships of any kind, okay? And maybe I'm just one of those radical, crazy Christians, okay? We've talked in these terms with our kids since they were very, very little. I remember when our girls were little, we started talking about when you find a husband, he needs to love Jesus Christ. Not just be a churchgoer, you understand, but he needs to love Jesus Christ, and he needs to be pursuing him and lead his family in that. We've always talked to our kids like that. And so I just think, this isn't a sermon on parenting, but let me digress a little bit, okay? If you're a parent here today, I would think it would be an urgency in your heart that when your kids get to the dating age, and maybe they're already there, maybe they're past that, I don't know. But when they get to the dating age and they find someone they're interested in and they want to date them, I think one of the first questions that ought to come out of our mouths if we're followers of Christ, parents, moms, dads, is, our son or daughter brings someone home, we say, do they love Jesus Christ with all their heart? And does their life demonstrate that? Because if the answer is no, then I don't really know what there is to talk about after that. Right? I mean, and I know it's radical. I know it's like, man, that's going to cause some blowback. And sometimes we're tempted, aren't we, parents, to lower the bar of God's word and just say, you know, because we don't want to fight that battle and we don't want to cause that friction. And it's easy because it's going to bear conflict and we fear pushing our kids into something worse. I get that. But listen, you will never ultimately be sorry for ordering your life, your family, lining your life up with your family on the Word of God. Ever, ever. You will never, ever be sorry. I'm not saying it'll always be easy. I'm not saying it'll go smoothly always, but please hear me. Nothing ever good comes from lowering the bar of God's Word. Nothing ever good comes from compromising the value and the commands of God's Word. Only heartache and misery without exception. Your kids will not be the exception. You will not be the exception as a family. You know, it's a reality. So back to the story, Abraham does not want his son Isaac to experience this, okay? He knows that God has so much ahead of him for his future. And so Abraham instructs his servant to go back to the land of his family, not where they're living in Canaan, but back to the land of his family where he was called out of by God to find a wife from his own country. And from that country, he's going to be married to this wonderful woman. And Abraham, he has the faith to believe that God's going to do that. He's going to provide for his wife, a wife for his son Isaac. And Abraham gives his servant a pretty incredible promise that God's going to send an angel ahead of him and make his mission successful. In other words, he just has this deep-seated belief that God's going to provide and God's going to work all this out. He doesn't have to worry about how and when and why and where. He just has to follow God and say yes to him and keep on living in his presence, okay? So here we go. As we get ready to read in verse 39, the servant has made the trip. He's already in the land that Abraham's come from. He's preparing his heart. He's set on being faithful to carry out the commitment he's made to Abraham, his master. There's a calling on his life. This servant's going to be the instrument through which God does this incredible thing, all right? And so here it is. And if you think about it, this is pretty cool. The servant represents us in a lot of ways. The servant had a master. His name was Abraham. We have a master if we're followers of Christ, right? Our master is the Lord Jesus Christ, crucified and risen. The servant had a calling on his life. And those of us who have come to know Jesus Christ as our Savior, we have a calling on our lives. Mothers, you have an incredibly high calling on your life. God has called you to something incredible. The servant had a purpose. His purpose was to fulfill Abraham's desire to find a godly wife for Isaac. And we too have a purpose. And every day we're called to go out into our world. We're called to go to our families, go to our places of work, and live this calling out and fulfill the purpose God has for us, to do his will. And we know that's our assignment, right? I mean, every single day as followers of Christ, we're on a mission. And we get up and we go to carry it out. And we're excited about it, but we're often faced with the same feelings and the same doubts and the same fears as the servant of Abraham faced. All right, here we go. We're getting into the word right now. Verse 39, look at this with me. But I said to my master, what if I can't? I know you call me to this thing. I know you say God's going to help me and he's going to go before me. He's going to make me successful and I'm going to go find a wife for your son in this land where you came from. But what if I can't? What if I can't find a young woman who's willing to go back with me? Isn't that what we say to the Lord sometimes? Come on, moms, let me start with you here today, okay? Watching online, moms, let me start with you. You hear the word of the Lord that says to you, do not fear. God has not given you a spirit of fear. Do not worry. Even when it comes to your kid's future, I don't want you to worry. I want you to trust me. But sometimes we say, what if I can't? What if I can't? Moms, maybe ladies, he says, I want to teach you to live by the fruit of the Spirit. And I know this applies to all of us, but I'm talking to the moms right now, okay? I want to teach you to live by the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, patience, self-control. I want you to live that out even when your toddler's swinging on your last nerve and you got a headache that's just about to split your head wide open and you're just flat out exhausted. I want to teach you to live like that. Well, what if I can't? What if I can't? How about parents? I want you to love that teenager. I want you to love them unconditionally. I want you to show them the love of Christ that laid down his life for him, even when they're pushing buttons you didn't even know you had. what if I can't? How about this, ladies? In a world where people tend to show only the Instagram-worthy parts of their life, and the temptation is fierce to compare yourself against another woman who you think has a Pinterest-perfect life, God says, I want you to draw your self-worth. I want you to draw your value from me, what I say about you, my word. What if I can't? How about this? Well, I want you to invite that family to church next Sunday. I want you to start being the spiritual leader of your home. I want you to take serious measures to break loose from that habitual sin that is destroying your life and preventing you from living in the abundant joy of the Lord. I want you to do that. I want you to start discipling children and teens. I want you to be my witness in this world. I want that too, but what if I can't, we say. How about maybe as a church, when God calls us to do something monumental, take a step of faith that is equal to marching around the walls of Jericho and experiencing the victory he wants to give us. Maybe living in radical compassion and generosity to our community that might rival the feeding of the 5,000 and how the disciples must have felt. I got to feed all these people with just a few loaves of bread and some scrawny fish. What if I can't? What if I can't do it? And we hear those words of the God and we receive those instructions and we know what God's wanting us to do and we have a heart to obey. We really do. But then doubt starts to dilute our faith and all the concerns start to creep in and we have these own voices, our own inner voices of insecurity come around and the voices from others start chattering in our ear saying, this is too big and this is too much and this is too risky. And sometimes we just cry out like the servant of Abraham and we say, what if I can't? What if I can't do it? And I want to encourage you this morning, whenever we start to feel the what if I can't spirit rise up within us, we sure need someone like Abraham to speak into our life. We sure need someone like Abraham who had seen God to do some mighty, mighty things and prove himself faithful time and time and time again. We need someone like Abraham to remind us that God is powerfully present with us always, and he has promised to be with us and give us success if we'll just trust him. He calls you to be faithful. And 1 Thessalonians 5:24 says, he is faithful and he will do it. Amen. How's that for a promise? Amen. It's good stuff. What if I can't? In the case of the servant is, what if I can't make this 500-mile journey and I can't find a wife and she won't come with me and for my master's son? But what is it for you? Whatever it is for you, here's what we have to realize. The what if I can't spirit that we've all experienced at times, it's born out of a spirit of fear. And God has not given us a spirit of fear, has he? Say no. The Bible says that very loud and clear. No, he's not giving us a spirit of fear. It's born out of a lack of confidence in God's character. Whenever we say, what if I can't? We're focused more on ourselves than on God. And it's born out of a forgetful heart that has forgotten how incredibly powerful and faithful God has been to me in my past whenever I've called upon him in faith. And I just want to encourage you in the strongest way possible that whenever you sense that rising in your heart or coming out of your mouth, you have to slam the lid down on that as fast and as forcibly as possible. And you have to run from that. And you have to take that thought captive. And you have to flee from that hard attitude. And what you really have to do is run into the very presence of God. You have to run in those moments right into the presence of God and let him remind you of his limitless power available to those of us who believe. It's all about living in the presence of God. James chapter 4 says this, 4:7, I think it is. Submit yourselves then to God and resist the devil and he will flee from you. He'll flee from you. That call to resist is so vital because so often the enemy is relentless to pound us with fear, saying, you know what? You can't do it. You are failing as a mom. You're failing as a parent. All your investment, all your time, all your teaching, it doesn't matter. It's not making a difference. It's not going to impact their future at all of your kids. The enemy is relentless with those lying messages. There's no need to pray. You'll never see your loved one saved. You'll never see victory in that area. You'll never experience the breakthrough you've been seeking God for, and you have to resist those lies. You have to run from those lies, those schemes of intimidation, because whatever the plan or dream that God has laid on your heart, and maybe he's even confirmed to you even now, the enemy comes along behind and says, that'll never happen. That'll never happen. And we have to be really careful to guard our hearts, because that what if I can't spirit rises up inside of us. And if left unchecked, it'll lead us to incredible discouragement and maybe even defeat. And so it's really important that we take note of that. But here's the perspective we need to live above the lies of the enemy and even above our own feelings, okay? And that pull us away from the promise that God wants to fulfill in our lives. And we see this so clearly. This is awesome. Get a hold of this. We see this so clearly in Abraham's response to his servants, what if I can't questions, okay? Verse 40, look at it with me. He says, he responded, the Lord in whose presence I have lived will send his angel with you and will make your mission successful. I love that. How on earth can Abraham be so confident when the solution isn't even on the horizon yet? It appears that it's nowhere in sight. How can he be so confident? Is this just the power of positive thinking? Is it just good old-fashioned stubborn determination? Is it just a matter of looking in the mirror five times a day and saying, you can do it, you can do it, you can do it, you can do it? No, it's none of those things. It's none of that at all. He was only able to live with confident hope, even though the answer was nowhere in sight. He was able to believe God for what God had promised him because of this one thing. He chose to live his life with a continual awareness of the presence of God. He cultivated. His entire life was orientated around this thing. He cultivated the priority of living in God's presence. I mean, it was just his lifestyle. It wasn't something he did on Sunday, you understand. It was just his very lifestyle. And that's the only place you're going to find it too. That's the only place you're going to find the strength and the grace and the anointing that you need so desperately to do God what God's called you to do. That's the only way, all right? Now, here we go. You ready? Here's an amen opportunity, all right? I'm waving the flag. I've given you plenty of opportunity. Ready? Plenty of notice. Here it comes, the amen opportunity. There is power in the presence of God. That's right. There's power in the presence of God. If you're not sure what to do, if you know God's leading you somewhere, but you're not sure where, if you're sensing a call in your life to something more, but you're not quite sure what it is, listen, the clarity you need, the revelation you need, the anointing you need, the grace to obey that you need, the wisdom you need to find out what pleases the Lord, because for crying out loud, what else in life matters than that? Pleasing the Lord is all that matters. It will only be found when you are in the presence of God. It will only be found as you make it a real priority to carve out that time in the midst of a nonstop world to be in the presence of God, to press in close to him, to be still before him, to abide in him, to listen to him. You know, if there's one thing I could lead you to do as your pastor, beyond completely forsaking your sins and your sinful life and turning to Jesus Christ as your Savior, beyond that, if there's one thing I could lead you to do, it'd be simply this right here, to cultivate a consistent habit of quickly running to the presence of God. To just develop this default response that I got to get in the presence of God. I got to spend some time there. I can't leave there until I hear from God, until I feel his presence in my life. Abraham responded to the servant, what if I can't? He said, the Lord in whose presence I have lived. In Lord whose presence I have lived. It doesn't mean he's not living there now. He's just saying this has been the consistent characteristic of my life from the very beginning. Now, this is really cool. Listen to this. Earlier in the passage, when Abraham says, you must not take a wife for my son among the daughters of the Canaanites, but go to my own country, to my own relatives, and get a wife for my son there. And then here's what the servant says. The servant says, and I'm at the very beginning of the story, because remember, what we read was a retelling of the story. At the beginning of Genesis 24 is what actually happened. And at the beginning, the servant says, but what if I can't find a young woman who will travel so far from home? And then notice he asked this. He's kind of offering an alternative plan. Should I then take Isaac? Okay, you want me to get a wife from there? Got it. What if she won't come back with me? It's a long journey. It's dangerous. Should I take Isaac and go marry her and live there from the land you came from? Now, all that seems reasonable, right? That seems like a reasonable plan to accomplish the end goal. Get a wife for Isaac. And it really makes sense because if you think about it, Sarah, Abraham's wife, Isaac's mom, is already dead. Abraham is old. He's well along in years, which is a nice way to say he could die at any moment. Isaac is now 40 years old, and he's a bachelor. There's no really significant prospects in sight for him finding a wife. And so it would have made perfect sense. It would have been so reasonable for Abraham to say, you know what? You're right, servant, whatever his name was. You're right. Let's just do whatever we have to do. I mean, I guess it's not going to work out like we expected it. And we don't have a lot of time here. We don't have a lot of time to wait on God. And so just do whatever you have to do. Get a wife for my son Isaac. That would have made really good sense if the ultimate goal was to only find a wife for Isaac. But that was not the ultimate goal. The ultimate goal was to honor God and to leave a godly legacy. That was the ultimate goal. And so when the servant suggests that he take Isaac back to the family homeland and just settle down there, Abraham says, no way, not a chance. Verse 6, make sure you do not take my son back there. That's really awesome. You see, when a man or woman spend times in the presence of God, real time, you don't settle for what's convenient. You don't settle for what's quick and easy. You don't settle for what's practical given the situation, given the circumstances. No, all you desire to do is to please the Lord, to obey Him, to trust Him completely, no compromises, to take Him at His word, no matter how crazy it seems to others on the outside. And Abraham says, listen, verse 7, we can't do that. I know that seems rational and quick, but we can't do that because the Lord God of heaven, who brought me out of my father's house and out of my native land, who spoke to me and He promised me, wait a minute, Abraham. When did God speak to you? When exactly did you hear from God? When exactly did He make you this incredible promise? When I was in His presence. When I was in His presence, listen, he speaks to us. He spoke to me, Abraham says. He says, to your offspring, I will give this land, the land of the Canaanites. I don't want you getting a wife from here, but this is going to be our land soon. This same God is going to send His angel ahead of you. He's going to see to it that you get a wife for my son from there. He's going to make your mission successful. Don't you love the confidence of Abraham? Don't you want that confidence in your heart? Don't you want to live like that? Don't you want to lead others with that same confidence that He's promised you, that you actually know you've heard from Him? That's why I'm so excited about this new series we're starting next Sunday. I love Abraham's unwavering confidence in God. He says, you know what? Don't worry about what if I can't and what if she won't and all this stuff. Listen, God's got this. God's got this. So, hey, servant, chill out, relax. We don't have to worry about what and where and why and how and if and all this stuff. We just have to step out in faith. We just have to say yes to Him and keep right on living in His presence. That's our role. That's what we do. And I just wonder, before we leave here this morning, do you have a hunger in your heart to spend some real time in the presence of God? Just to linger a little while at least, to be really intentional about seeking Him. And I wonder, as we do this, as we get ready to worship, in fact, why don't the praise team just join me right back up here. As we get ready to worship and spend time in His presence, I wonder if God would do what He did for the servant. I wonder if He'd begin to fill your heart with a fresh measure of faith that He's going to go before you this week in your everyday, ordinary life. He's going to go before you, and He's going to make your mission successful. He's going to empower you. Listen, He's going to empower you to do everything He's called you to do. Moms, He's going to go before you. I want you to hear from God today. You've heard from God. This is His word. Moms, He's going to go before you. And each and every day, He's going to prepare you. And He's going to strengthen you. And He's going to help you. Even in those days you feel like quitting. Even those days you're tempted because you've been hearing the lies of the enemy all day saying it doesn't matter. It's not going to matter. No, it does matter. What you do matters. You've got a calling from God. You've got a purpose. You're His servant. What you do for the Lord. He's going to go before you and make your mission successful. Dads, men of God, He's going to strengthen you to be the man of God He calls you to be. He's going to help you. He's going to go before you. He's going to go with you. In fact, if you're a follower of Jesus, His very Spirit lives in you. He's going to give you the power to stay on mission from Him, even when the enemy's pounding on you, trying to pull you off the path, trying to make an example out of you. How about this? He's gonna make our mission as a church successful, amen? No matter what we walk through, no matter what tomorrow holds, next week, next year, He's making our mission successful. What about the mission of marriage? He's going to give you success and the mission to build a godly marriage that goes the distance. I could go on and on and on, but what I want to say to you is that God is for you and he's with you, and this can be a reality for you today. So if you want to stand, we're just going to worship here. I want to pray for you. Let me do that now as they're setting up. Father God, thank you. Thank you for the power of your word. Thank you for the joy of today. God, you're no less present when we're online as when we're here. You're no less able to speak to us in those ways. But God, thank you that we're able to start this process of regathering. I'm so encouraged. I believe you've touched hearts today. I believe you've built faith today. I believe you encouraged some people today that you are with them. And they should never, ever forget that your power is found in your presence. Help us to seek you with all of our heart this week. Help us to run to you this week with our problems and our joys and our trials and our concerns and our questions. And Lord, help us to stand strong in this world for you, to draw others to you. We love you, God. Encourage your people. Strengthen your church today, I pray. In Jesus' name. Now, if you just keep your head bowed for one more prayer, for one more minute. I just want to offer this invitation. That's all it is. I can't make anybody do this. I can't drag anybody to the feet of God and have them submit their lives to him and be saved. It's a choice we all make. But I want to give the invitation. You know, yesterday I stood right here on the stage. And we had the memorial service for a friend of ours who attended this church. He was 1 year younger than I am. He died very suddenly, just here recently. And we had his memorial service yesterday. The cool thing is he was committed his life to Christ, and one of his light bulb is up on that board right there. Or maybe it's that one. I don't know. I think it's that one. That was the first one. And he was baptized right here. He was baptized right here. He stood on the stage, and he confessed his faith in Jesus. And because of that, he's with the Lord forever. There's no more tears. There's no more sadness or sickness or dying or pain. I'm so grateful for the gift of life. And it's available to you today is what I want to say. Romans 6:23 says, "The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life." If you're listening right now online, listen to the most important thing I can ever say to you. The wages of sin, the wages of saying, "I'll do it my way. I don't need God. I'll do it on my own. I'll drive the car. Thank you very much." The wages of that ends up in death. And not just physical death, but eternal death, separated from the Lord forever. But the gift of God in Christ Jesus is eternal life. It's that clear. It's that simple. The choice between death and the choice between life. So I want to simply ask, if you want to choose life today, if you want to choose to give your life to Jesus and begin this amazing, amazing, indescribable journey of following him and experiencing how he can transform your life and make you brand new from the inside out, all you have to do is say yes to him. We're going to pray a prayer, and I want to lead you in that prayer. If you offer this prayer to God, he will hear you and he will save you from sin, from eternal death, and he will give you the gift of eternal life. And he'll help you to follow him from this day forward. Let's pray this together. If you want in on this prayer, you pray it right now from your heart with me. And let's pray it all together if we're in this room right here. Just in case anybody, we won't make anybody pray this by themselves. We want to support them in their step of faith. So everybody pray it together. Father God, I turn to you today. I admit that I'm a sinner. I ask your forgiveness. Heal me. Cleanse me of all wrongdoing. I believe you died on the cross for me. And I confess with my mouth that Jesus is my Lord. Help me to follow you. Help me to share you with others and to do your will from this day forward. I pray this in faith in the name of my risen Savior, Jesus. Amen. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, if you're here, would you slip up your hand? Would you slip up your hand? We're not going to call you up front. We're not going to call you to speak out. We want to know so we can congratulate you and give you some resources. If you're online right now, can you text the word Jesus? Can you text the word Jesus or let somebody know somehow, some way online? If you prayed that prayer and you meant it, text the word Jesus to that same number we gave earlier, 785-728-4433. We'll send you some resources to continue to encourage. This is not a destination, you understand. This is the beginning of a journey with God where your life's going to change forever, where God goes with you and before you every day. All right? Amen. We're glad if you did that. We celebrate with that. Let's just celebrate in faith, shall we? All right? And let's spend some time in the presence of God before we leave here today. Let's worship and let's just spend some time in the presence of God. He has all that you need. It's been so good to be together. Let's worship Him.